and Asta, if you could have you. I was given a lot of information as introduction to all of them, but I think I'll dispense with that. Producer, of course, needs no introduction except for the fact that, owing to the fact that if after 40 years of being a legendary filmmaker, you are still 12th fail, you don't need an introduction. Dr. Parekh, of course, is one of our leading mental health experts in this country. I was very happy to work with him on a book on the COVID epidemic, probably the first book. And even as the lockdown was happening, he was making that book happen. Welcome, Dr. Parekh. It is wonderful to have you. And Asta, of course, she has, in the last couple of years, made a real impact with her podcast, which is so wonderfully titled Slow Down with Asta. And one just needs to listen to that to be able to slow down. As Anuja, who has been behind this, putting this together, mentioned in one of her mails that it's at times the best thing one does during the course of the day, listen to some of her podcasts. Yay. Thank you, Asta, for doing this. I'll just, before we get into the release proper of the book, I'll invite Vidhu to say a few words.
So this is a very, very special day for me, because I think this book has taken a few years, and I really want to thank Shantanu and Dr. Rajesh Parekh, with whom actually this whole journey started. When we came to know the first time that Isha was unwell, Rajesh, what I call Dr. Parekh, Rajesh flew with me and Anu all the way to Canada to Edmonton. You remember that? How many years back to that? So this journey has started with him, and I'm so happy that he's here releasing this book for us. Thank you very much. And I really, really, the patience that Shantanu has had is remarkable, and the job that Anuja, who will not like to like her, she is hiding because I mentioned her name, but she, along with Shantanu, did a great job of finally putting the book together. I'm extremely thankful, Anuja, Shantanu, and for you to come. I heard your podcast first time yesterday, so I'm a new convert. Thank you.
The same thing that I asked Dr. Parekh. What has been your experience of dealing with people in the course of your podcast, also about the awareness about various, Dr. Parekh mentioned it from a medical point of view, but from a general perspective, you know, like, do you think there's awareness of these differences, or do you think we are sort of struggling to make that distinction?
Hello. Okay. In my experience, I think one is there is definitely a lack of awareness, and most people restrict the term mental health to just depression, suicide, anxiety. And what happens is that basically within the space of understanding depression, anxiety and suicide, there are so many misconceptions. I lost a friend to suicide, who was from a very prominent family in Bandra. And I remember the newspapers wrote, Pali Hill boy takes his own life. And the comments on the digital versions of the article was, but why did he do that? His parents gave him a BMW at the age of 18. Now, when we're talking about misconceptions, I think the biggest one I've noticed in the field of mental health in general is that, one, if you have access to any form of material comfort in your life, if you are successful, if you're good looking, if you're wealthy, how could you possibly have any form of mental health disorder? So that's the first one. I think the second one I've noticed is very specific to what people think of therapy and counseling as. So I have friends who say, you're taking therapy, you must be having suicidal thoughts. Or there's this misconception that the therapist has a magic wand and you go for one session of therapy and your life is supposed to change. There's no commitment required from your side to the process, and that's where people go wrong or even give up on the process. In fact, there's one thing I really wish to salute Isha for is she never gave up on the process. She's written so many times in the book about how she kept going to different therapists or counselors and really finding the mental health practitioner who works for you is a journey in itself. So these are some of the misconceptions, and what I feel is sometimes the most normal people around you could be having a mental health illness and they could be high performing individuals. So there are so many people I know who are highly educated, gone, you know, got the fanciest degrees from abroad. It's a friend of mine and he said, you know, Asa, even if I was madly in love with a girl, if I knew she's battling a mental health illness or has a history of mental health illness, I would leave her. And I said, why? I said, why would you leave someone like that? And he said, kuch karwar legi to mujh pe aayega na. So there's so many misconceptions that a person with a mental health illness is a burden, is a liability, cannot be lived with. And I mean, I think I just scratched the surface, but in my observation, these are the few things that people tend to think of when we talk about mental health. Dr. Parekh, actually this question is directed to you because I get asked a lot, people for some reason mistake me to be a mental health practitioner. So I receive a lot of messages from people who actively are looking for help, but they're so intimidated by the words that they don't know, do I have to first go to a psychiatrist or a counselor or a life coach or a neuro coach? It's become a very complicated space. So on behalf of maybe the audience, where does someone begin?
I think you're right, but to an extent, Asta. I mean, that's a paradox of it. It has become a complicated space, but has also become an enormously simplified space. And that's thanks to people like you, thanks to Isha, thanks to some of the people I see. I see Vedika Podar, who's, you know, does podcasts in mental health. So thanks to the efforts of a lot, the media who's present over here, it's also becoming very simplified. And during the pandemic, because of the conditions imposed by the pandemic on us, isolation, etc., there was an enormous growth in the need for mental health. And that's something you would have expected. But what really surprised me, and maybe that's your generation, is how open it became. You know, people would openly write, and you probably see it a lot more than I do. I'm not very much on social media. But people write about what they're going through. They make recommendations. You know, I started getting reviews, a whole lot of reviews. Those Google reviews, at one point they were over 500. And then Google cut them down, I don't know why, so they're still around 450. And you know, I turned to my children and I said, I'm now like a restaurant. But I get patients who come to me, and I'm always curious, you know, why have they come to me? Some of them don't need to see me. As you said, they need to go to the counselor. So I read your Google review. So, you know, there has been a paradigm shift, or a generational shift, if I may call it that, in the openness, in the approach to mental health, in accepting that illness is not a sign of weakness, that there is no shame, there is no stigma. And I think the brave people, amongst whom I, you know, count Isha, I count all of you over here, Anu, Zuni, the whole family, they talk about this. And you're spearheading this campaign. And I'm old enough to have seen the advent of feminism. I'm old enough to see what happened with the gay movement, you know, in San Francisco and other places in the 70s and 80s. And there were always leaders who put themselves on the line. They're like the COVID workers, like some of us frontline workers in COVID. We took risks. We went out there. We did our job. And I think there are people who are doing that in mental health. So yes, a little complex, but you know, given the choice between keeping it under wraps and not talking about it, and on the other extreme, the other end of the spectrum, having a plethora of choices to the point it becomes complex, I hope you agree with me that the second is preferable to the first. So, yeah.
How difficult was it to get Isha to persevere with this? You know, like one of the things that doctor did mention, that you need to stay the course, you know. And did you ever, in the course of these 10 years, feel like Isha is on the verge of giving up, or, you know, you were sort of stressed about that? And how did you, a family has to play that important role. So what was your role in making, did Isha think of giving up, mere se to nahi hoga main, and doomed to be this way, and to the extent that she recovered enough to be able to write about it? So what was it like driving her to stay the course, to persevere?
See, my job was primarily to take her stress on. And I think that should be the first thing that a caretaker or a family should do. It's like, I hate the comparison, but these days, since I'm writing a fantasy, I have to say, because this image came to my mind, that when Shiva did the Salamandhan, among other things, there was poison that he held back in the throat, that's why he called Nilkanth. I think that the job of the family is to take that poison, the darkness, out of the mind of the family member who's suffering, and really hold it, literally, to himself and bear with it. So whatever Isha has done, Isha has done. But yes, over so many years, I have tried my best, and everybody with me has tried our best to take her stress and take it away, as much as possible, take it away from her. That's the only thing we can do as a family.
That of course, talk about this friend of yours and how he didn't get the care that he should have, that could have prevented the tragedy, you know. And one of the things that Isha does mention in a great detail is, you know, the role of the caregiver, and how for the person suffering, that particular episode might go from memory the moment, you know, you've had that episode, doesn't remember. But for the caregiver, it's always a continued stress or a continued sort of thing that he or she goes. So if you could just, you know, talk about your experience with this friend, and what have you seen about a family being coming together for, or not being able to come together, if you just could talk about.
So I've actually seen two extremes, which is either the family is extremely supportive. My parents have been extremely supportive. They're here today as well. There have been times where I have wanted to give up on the process, and they have said, no, maybe it's this person that's not working out. Don't leave the process. In the case of this friend of mine, as Dr. Parit said, our generation is actually very proactively looking to take charge of mental and emotional wellness, to learn to do the work that is required to kind of build your mental resilience and strength. Unfortunately, in the case of this boy, he tried very, very hard to convince his parents, and kind of, there was a point at which the counselor said, I need to see your parents. You are now showing signs of suicidal behavior. And the first thing that the boy told the counselor, sir, my parents will not come. They don't believe there is anything wrong with me. And the counselor said, but you have been clinically evaluated, and this is based on an assessment that has been done on your mental state of being. Call them, I will speak to them. And he said, sir, nothing will work. His parents were unaware of the fact that he was going for therapy.
Were you, as friends, you know, like, I'll count friends among the caregivers, you know, a sort of extended circle of friends, close friends. Were you aware of this boy's condition?
Yes.
And did you?
We tried to speak.
With a family?
Yes. And it was a shocker to me, because in that, at least you would think that in this educated strata of society, business, family, you sent the kid abroad to study, and your child is literally giving you a cry for help and saying, I'm doing my bit, now I need you to hold my hand. And I don't know sometimes if people genuinely don't understand mental wellness, because I've seen that side as well, where I've had friends who say, but how can you be so sad that you want to take your own life? I just don't understand it. So there's genuinely sometimes an inability to grasp how can sadness become so extreme that a person wants to believe that no longer being alive itself is better than being alive. And unfortunately, in the case of this boy, also I want to say there's a reason when we're talking about depression specifically that it's called the invisible illness. So this boy, his parents would see him otherwise behaving normal, going to college, going out to party once in a while. So that thing was that he was just doing natak. This is all in your head. That was the mentality. And then he took his own life. So what a tragedy that the child was willing to take help. But I mean, I just want to stress on that's where the support system comes. And there have been so many times where he would have a mental breakdown, and just by our friends being around him and giving him an ear and saying, what are you going through? Talk about it. You want to cry? He would instantly feel better. So whether that support system comes in the form of your friends accepting you and not judging you, your family, though ideally your family should really have your back in such situations. I think Isha is blessed that she's had the support, and even I consider myself extremely blessed to have supportive parents. I cannot stress the importance of having family support in our lives.